Why do you walk into it? But the Twisted Fae's messing up because he's just firing his cues, isn't it? Twisted Fae should really be firing it right about now. Yeah, Twisted Fae should have fired his cue earlier, but when I said now, it would have traveled right as he was passing towards it. Oh, nice, he got the cannon. Smart Twisted Fae. Yeah, why are we putting the ball down?
This guy is just farming with Q.
Oh yeah? Nice, good defense. Oh, I think you got him. Yeah. Damn, that's a really smart tier player. Holy shit. What the fuck is Cadrel listening to music wise? Bro, what in the. The music is dead. Oh, free concert. We can't see that because there is the. Wait, what am I doing? Bro, what?
Heather Dinich joining the program. Heather, you are going to be so busy from Grapevine, where the assembled committee is meeting. Our selection show is at noon. So how will they assess number 7 Texas winning their conference, number 8 Alabama, losing to that Texas team, but winning the SEC. What's that conversation going to be like?
Gary, I think it's going to be a similar conversation to what it's been all season to this point, and that head-to-head win in Tuscaloosa in week two will continue to be a huge part of the discussion. It has given Texas an edge over Alabama every week to this point, and Selection Committee Chair Boo Corrigan said earlier this week that it doesn't matter when it happened, it means as much today as it did then. The thing about these two teams is that both of them now have two of the best wins in the country. Alabama knocked off the committee's number one.
In Michigan and Washington are undefeated, so
hold on.
Can claim something.
Tech, they do not have the two best records in the country. It's undefeated Michigan, undefeated Washington. What? What are y'all spewing? Nonsense, man. Just nonsense. Look, what was it at? Look at the rankings. Georgia lost. So Michigan, Washington, Florida State are undefeated. Those three teams are the best records in the country. How you can sit here and say Texas and Alabama has the best records in the country? Oh my goodness. That is some, like, cognitive dissonance that just...
Hey everybody, Riot Mort here with a special early edition of the patch 13.20.
I know it's going to be that.
Now, this patch goes live on Wednesday, December 6th, and normally I would post this rundown on Sunday, but with the Vegas competition coming up, the Vegas Open will be played on this patch. Wanted to give people as much information as possible early, so if they want to play around with this patch, maybe scrim, all of these changes are on PBE right now. So you could be aware of it and practice for the Vegas Open if you so choose. Again, this is the patch that will be played on the Vegas Open, so kind of an important patch. We wanted to keep things relatively small, but we've seen after launch that the patch has kind of isolated down to a few strategies, baked around things like Superfan, Jazz, stuff like that, Zigs. So keeping the changes relatively small here, but should mix things up and hopefully lead to an even healthier meta as we head into the Vegas Open. So, let's jump right in. The first thing is minor. This is barely worth paying attention to, but we've renamed a bunch of the portals. This is mostly to deal with localization and making sure that the strings fit. That's really the motivation behind this. There isn't anything else to that. So we had to change some of the wordings. In English, you might be like, oh, this isn't shorter, but in other languages it is. It's really just about localization. So no other changes other than text here. The other one is for hyper role players. Stage 10 now has three additional PvP combat rounds, so you're not going to lead into these weird situations where, you know, you're at 18 health and then you go to stage 11 and lose and take 30 damage. That shouldn't be happening, so that will be fixed for hyper role. That's it on the system side, so like I said, nothing major here. On the trait side, 8-bit is a trait that really hasn't taken off. It's kind of hard to play because when you first put it in, it actually does close to nothing, and you have to really ramp it up for it to be valuable, and that ramping can take time. So a lot of the time you're playing down a trait. So we're powering this trait up quite a bit, actually. It's going from 3.5/6/10 to 4.5/7.5/12. Now that's maximum is multiplied by 10, so 45/75/120 at max. You know, for a four-piece giving you 75% AD, that's pretty high. For comparison, Crowd Diver is 70% damage at 6 right now, so that is a big trait, but it will require stacking. This should be a healthy buff and hopefully make some of the 8-bit lines a little bit more playable. The other thing is that the grand prize score for 6 8-bit, we hear you, it's way too hard to hit. It has been hit, but it is way too hard. It requires too much. We do want to make it hard, but accessible. So we're lowering it quite a bit here. 345,678, a little less than hyper roll. Again, it's still going to be tough. Honestly, this might even need to come down further, but we want to take it slow. But this should at least, you know, it is 111,000 off, so it should be more achievable if you're trying to go for that. On the nerf side, country is getting a very small invisible nerf here. The three-piece, for those who don't know, when Hecarim comes out, he gives your team 20% attack speed. That's going to go down to 15%. Should just help keep early three country in the early game just a little down. No big deal. And the five-piece gives 20% Omnivamp to all the country units. It is only the country units, but that is also going to go down to 15%. Again, should hopefully be kind of barely noticeable, but just the nudge country needs. Guardian. This is a bigger nerf. Guardian was definitely overstatted compared to some of the other survivable traits like Brawler, or Bruiser, and Sentinel. So Guardian is getting hit. At 2, it's only going to go from 30 to 25. At 4, it's going to go from 50 to 40. And at 6, it's going to go from 70 to 60. This is one of the things that will nerf the Superfan package. Nico and Kennen will get less shields from Guardian. It should make those 4 Guardian mid-games actually a little bit more tolerable. So it is going to nerf the Guardian line a bit. Right now, it was kind of the premier front line. Jazz is the other big one. This is a big nerf. This is not a small nerf, but realistically, Jazz was very easy to slot in. We really underestimated how easy it would be to build late-game boards that had 7, 8, 9 traits. We've just seen, you know, people buy a lot of the legendaries, optimize with like 2 Rapid Fire, 2 Sentinel, things like that, and then throw in a Misfortune and a Bard, or a Misfortune and a Lucian commonly, to get that Rapid Fire, and it's just too much power. So we are going to be nerfing it. The HP is the big one, because, man, it gives you a lot of HP. Getting upwards of, you know, 40% HP for your entire team is too much. So the HP is going to go down quite a bit here, from 234 to 1.523. So again, chunky nerf there. And the damage is also going to go down, but only at 3 and 4. We don't want to nerf too much here, but the damage is going to go from 123 to 1.52. So again, this is a chunky nerf, but it should open up more lines and feel like you don't have to play Jazz in the endgame without missing out on massive amounts of stats. So probably the biggest nerf in the patch. With the second biggest nerf being Kennen, because Kennen has another nerf we'll talk about later, but Kennen also got Guardian hit, things like that. Kennen also, for being as tanky as he is providing too much damage, because he's also a super fan. He's got that true damage. So the damage is getting about a 10% nerf here. Cassante, definitely one of the weakest front lines in the game right now. We're trying to give him a little less downtime, where he's not in that tanky stance. So the mana's going to go from 60 to 40. And he'll slap back a little harder. We're not expecting this to open up like some weird AD build or anything like that, but we do want Cassante to survive a little longer. This should help both Sentinel and Heartsteel especially be able to play around that. Yasuo, we're giving Yasuo a buff. It's a very small one, but again, with Vegas coming up, we couldn't go too big here. So he's getting about a 5% buff on his spell. That's going to go from 275 to 290. Should hopefully make Yasuo a potential option to play, along with some of the other buffs and some of the other nerfs. And then finally, Yone on the 1, 2, and 3 costs, so no 2 costs, but hold on, don't freak out, Katarina people. Yone here is going to get some extra HP, and his spell's going to hit a little harder. Again, very minor buffs here. I actually believe Yone needs a little more than this, but we didn't want to overbuff Heartsteel, and again, Edgelord, same thing. We don't want to like buff Yasuo and Yone and Kane and go too crazy. So we are going very conservative this patch. Again, that is the big message here, trying to keep it conservative. So, small HP buff, small damage buff, hopefully opens up some Yone lines. Doesn't solve all the problems like him having to deal with Thresh plus Echo and just getting stunned to death, things like that. Those will have to wait until after Vegas. Alright, 4 cost. This is probably the biggest batch of changes here, and you can see it's a lot of green text. 4 costs right now kind of feel like the cost you skip. Yes, there's the Karthus KDA Akali line, but really other than that, you know, some of the tanks, you kind of skip all these champions. You go straight to 5, or so the level 9, play the 5 cost, things like that. So all of these champions are getting pretty sizable buffs, actually. Akali's going to gain some attack speed, and her spell's going to hit harder. This is the true damage Akali. Caitlyn's spell is going to hit harder. We went light on Caitlyn because she did get that big 8-bit buff, and she's kind of the 8-bit carry. So the combination of those two should help her. Ezreal is getting some more attack speed, so he'll get to his ult quicker. And the single target spell damage is going up. We're not buffing that ult. That ult is really good, but it takes him a little long to get that, so that attack speed should help. Viego, we're buffing the slam damage quite a bit, actually.
Shit.
It is just the slam. Most of his damage is actually the autos afterwards, not the slam. But if you invest AD items on Viego, this should feel rewarding, and that slam should hit hard. And then Zed getting a small buff. Zed is one of those champions that actually does have some playable builds that are pretty hard, so we didn't want to overbuff Zed. He might need more later, especially around EDM. EDM is a trait that is clear.
Justice is coming.
But again, the pre-Vegas, want to be conservative, and this is actually mostly to compensate for the Crowd Diver nerf you're going to see later, more than anything else. But again, hopefully some of these AD carries should be playable in the, you know, stage 4-2 to 4-6 kind of area, and open up some more lines. And then on the 5-cost side, Kane clearly the worst legendary, getting a big chunk of attack speed to help him cast quicker, and the cast is going up, you know, a little bit of damage here, about 5%. So Kane, again, might need more than this, to be honest. I think that spell damage might need to go up more. But again, don't want to overbuff for Vegas. And then Ziggs, this is the other really big nerf here. 5 more on the mana, which won't affect his Shojin build, really. But the big one here is he's not going to scale up nearly as fast. Going from 2 to 1 extra small bomb per cast, pretty big deal here. That is going to nerf Ziggs. So he shouldn't be the best 5 cost far and away anymore. Should still be a 5 cost, should still be valuable, but nothing too crazy. Okay, new category here for this set, headliner bonuses. As I mentioned, one of the cool things about this set this time is that every champion has a unique headliner bonus, and we can balance accordingly around those. So, Kennen, that 4% max heal that he gets per jolt, which means he casts 4 of those jolts usually because you've got his bling bonus activated, he was healing 16% of his health every cast. That's going to go all the way down to 8, 2% per jolt, so that is a nerf. Bard Headliner, very small nerf here. We don't want to overkill this with Jazz. Honestly, this one's debatable, but we just want to be careful. So small nerf to that Headliner Bard only. Base Bard should still be a really cool carry in the early game. He still hits like a truck, but just a bit of a nerf to that. Katarina Headliner, this one was definitely a little over budget. So loses 50 HP, and that final bounce, instead of doing 45% extra damage, is going to do 25% extra damage. But again, Katarina should still be good. We're not nerfing base Katarina, only the headliner, and only a little bit. Misfortune, same thing. Misfortune's traits are so valuable. Big Shot's also getting some buffs through things like 8-bit. We don't want to, and Ezreal, we don't want to overbuff Big Shot. So Misfortune AD is going to go down a bit. Samira Headliner is another one. Samira Headliner has that built-in AD plus the crit. The crit really empowers her. We didn't want to take away that. But the AD is going to go down to 5%. She's still a great champion, but we also don't want to nerf base Samira. We think that champion's fine. Headliner set. This is a nerf from 250 to 150, but it's mostly compensation for the fact we actually fixed his headliner. It will now stack and give HP. So overall, set headliner should be better, not worse. You'll actually get to take advantage of that. So just compensation there. Zac Headliner is going to get 50 more HP and 5 more AP. So if you want to go Zac Headliner, that should be a little bit better. And then Ziggs, kind of a second nerf here. The 10 mana reduction is going to go down to 5. So what this really means is Headliner Ziggs went from 60 mana to 70 mana. So Headliner Ziggs taking a big chunk. So 10 less mana plus the less bombs per cast should make Ziggs a little bit more balanced. And again, all of these, could we go harder? Maybe. But pre-Vegas, we don't want to be rapidly shifting the meta, so we're going to do this for Vegas and then reevaluate after. All right, on the augment side, not a lot of crazy stuff here. Good for Something 1 has been nerfed because we did bug fix it, for those who correctly called this. It is dropping at 50%, not the intended 30%. We fixed that bug. Reach the Summit now grants 10 gold and 50 XP. It felt a little weird to just get the XP and nothing to play with here, so it will grant 10 gold. Young, Wild, and Free now correctly drops gold. The tooltip says drops 3 gold, but it never did. So it is a buff, but it's already an augment that can do very well. So we're just lowering it to 2 gold. So overall, it went from 0 to 2 gold. It is technically...
It's not what I need.
Bigger Shot. This is a pretty big nerf. There was a bug where, you know, Bigger Shot says 65% damage on that AoE, but it was also hitting the primary target for an extra 100%. That bug has been fixed. So this augment has been nerfed because that bug has been fixed. Live for Danger, this is the Edgelord augment, has been buffed from 30% to 40%. Sorry, the color is wrong here. That's a buff, not a nerf. Live for Danger has been buffed. My bad. Ramping Rhythm. This is a weird augment that allows your rapid fires to stack all the way up to 30 stacks. It's really fun when it works, but it doesn't give you any initial power, which is pretty bad. So now it's going to start you at 3 stacks immediately. So if you've got 4 rapid fire, this augment starts you at 21% attack speed and then ramps up all the way up to 30 stacks. So that should make this augment a little bit better if you want to play a rapid fire build. Submit to the pit. All the stats given to moshers goes from 3 to 5. Pretty big buff for that augment, but kind of underperforming anyway. That's Jazz Baby. Probably one of the most overtuned augments combined with the trait here. But even with the trait nerf, this augment was still giving way too much value comparatively to other augments, especially gotten at 2-1. The cap was just way too high. So we're actually lowering the HP in half. You're going to have a lot less HP from this augment. But only the attack speed going down 1% here, so nothing too crazy. And we're not actually nerfing the AD and AP. So you can definitely still make a really powerful misfortune if you want to play this augment, but it isn't going to be a 34% win rate augment. So that should help. Binary Airdrop, very good augment, has been overperforming for a while. Now instead of granting a component, we'll grant 2 gold. That is a nerf. Endless Hordes, really doing well this set, especially with Jazz. Yes, Jazz has been nerfed, but the augment still will probably overperform. So we're lowering the HP reduction from 15% to 20%. Going Long now grants 8 gold immediately. Kind of a weaker March of Progress right now. Might still be, but at least the 8 gold will give you an option to power level and get ahead of that curve. So there should be a pretty big buff for Going Long. And then Infernal Contract, we're just giving 15 more gold. This is an augment that also kind of struggles, especially with some of the 3 costs. But at least having a little extra gold to roll might guarantee you hit some of those 3-star 3 costs that you're playing with this comp. Alright, traits. Some small trait changes. Very tiny things here. Bruiser, definitely underperforming at 4 and 6. People love playing 2. That 100 health matters a lot. But, especially with Alawi, who's an amazing champion. But 4 and 6, not really worth playing. Again, because it's Vegas, going very light for now. Probably needs more than this. I don't think this is magically going to make Bruiser meta, but hopefully should at least make it not a bait to play it, especially like 4 early. I imagine 4 Bruiser should be pretty good in the early game. Crowd Diver definitely caps out a little high at 6, so the 6 piece is being nerfed down to 60%. And then Executioner, this is one that I think for those of you who are like, hey, Akali and Karthus might need nerfs, this is kind of the Akali Karthus nerf that you're going to see. 2 Executioner was the big nerf we were aiming for here, going from 15 to 5%. Just the critical strike damage, not the chance, so Samira should still be fine and get those crits she needs. But then we had to nerf 4 because like going from 5 to 30 was too big a jump. So it's 5, 25, 45. If you want to go deep Executioner, should be fine. Again, may need some follow-up buffs to things like Twitch or Vex. But for now, this was what we needed for the Vegas. Finally, on the champ small side, for those of you that were looking for an Annie nerf, we don't actually think Annie needs that big a
pediatric
nerf, but it is way too easy to get a Shoujin, a Nasher, and then a second Shoujin from Superfan and play that really well early. So we're nerfing her by changing her Superfan item from Spear of Shoujin to Jeweled Gauntlet. Jeweled Gauntlet is not an optimal item for her, it's okay, but this shouldn't help you get best in slot as quick and easily. And that should be all the nerf she needs for now for Vegas, so the Annie line should still be playable. And then Ahri. Ahri is one that, if you hit 3-star Ahri and got 6th place, not calling out anyone in particular or myself or anything, you know that Ahri's big weakness is, even if she was hitting for 10,000 damage, she still has to go one target at a time, and that can be too slow, especially with things like Alawi tentacles, things like that. So now 3-star Ahri will fire 2 projectiles per cast, so allowing her to like actually mow through multiple things. This should be a pretty big buff. Obviously, we had to nerf the damage to compensate. We didn't even nerf it half though, so overall, this is still a buff to Ahri. But she should actually be able to like get through teams quite a bit quicker now if you hit 3-star Ahri. All right, and then bug fixes. A lot of bug fixes. Try to go through these quick here. Fixed an issue where sometimes Alawi would revive 2 tentacles with her cast instead of 1. Teaming up 1 now correctly grants 2 3 costs instead of 3, so that is a nerf to that augment. Akali properly combines when your bench is full. The Showtime portal is now available in Hyper Roll. Radiant Item portal now displays the correct round in its tooltip in Hyper Roll. Gambler's Blade and Diamond Hands now properly work in the artifact pool and are affected by things like Reforger, Pandora's Items. Kiana can no longer give units invisible 4th items. Your KDA pattern no longer changes after triggering Last Stand. Augment Little Buddies now works with True Damage Akali. She wasn't counting as a 4 cost for some reason. Wellness Fund, Risky Moves, and Tiniest Titan have been removed from the Double Up Augment pool. Gambler's Blade now correctly works in Hyper Roll and uses the Hyper Roll values. Using an item remover on a champion without enough empty item bench slots will now correctly bounce off rather than removing as many items as possible. Headliner sets permanent health now functions, called that out earlier. Poros on Poro Ranger HQ no longer disappear when zooming in. Health bar no longer blocks Chibi Kaisa when performing some of her emotes. For all Prancy's Angry Mark VFX are fixed, if you're a Prancy Little Legend fan. Blank Slate should no longer sell Tome of Traits on the bench. Submit to the Pit now only applies to moshers. Apparently it was applying to your whole team. Not that that made the augment any good, but at least now it applies to what it says it does. Blinged Out now counts full benefits for three Thieves Gloves. It was counting as one item. Now it counts as three. And then hopefully this one coming in a little hot here, but Double Up, we should have fixed the issue where Crowd Divers would become invulnerable for the rest of combat. Now again, this is generally a small patch, but things like the Jazz, the Guardian, the Kennen, the Ziggs, the Annie changes should be enough to shake up the meta a bit in a healthy state, plus those 4-cost buffs. And again, we're purposely being a little conservative. Now, for those of you that aren't participating in the Vegas Open, a reminder that we are going to ship another patch on December 13th, give or take. You can call that patch 1324B. It's almost a 1325 for all intents and purposes, but there will be one more bigger balance change before we head to the holidays that will include some more buffs to things, try to get even more lines viable, and allow us to react to Vegas. But again, we wanted to get this out here so that people participating in the Vegas Open could know what's going on and not drastically change things 2 days before a big event. So there you go. All right. So like I said, patch goes live December 6th. Hopefully everybody enjoys. Cool. Can't wait to see everybody at the Vegas Open. It's going to be a blast. All right. That's going to do it for me. Until next time, take it easy.
Check out the Google Pixel 8 Pro, Pixel Watch 2, Pixel Buds Pro, and Pixel Tablet. Engineered by Google, Pixel devices use AI to supercharge your day so you can save time, live healthier, and get more done.
Video and oxalates, especially in the relationship to flushing out oxalates from your kidneys to prevent kidney stones and other forms of crystallization of oxalates, which could show up as maybe a pseudogout or some type of inflammatory condition. There's actually quite a few problems related to oxalates. Let me just kind of run through the symptoms that a person could have if they have oxalate dumping or they're absorbing too many oxalates, okay? Of course, kidney stones are number one. The most common form of kidney stone is the calcium oxalate stone. You can also have these oxalates build up in the bone, the skin, the joints, and your blood vessels. And I already mentioned gout before. Gout doesn't necessarily always have to come from uric acid. It could come from the oxalates irritating that joint. You can also have headaches from oxalates, eye pain, urinary pain, genital pain, muscle pain, as well as intestinal pain. So here's the thing, there's a lot of foods with oxalates, okay? I mean, it's in a lot of different plants, it's in fruits, it's not in meats, it's not in dairy, but it's very high in like almonds, peanuts, spinach especially. It's in chocolate, kiwi, strawberries, beets, tea, and bran. But dietary oxalates are not correlated with oxalates in your urine. So in other words, they have not found that just because you consume foods high in oxalates, that you're going to have high oxalates in the urine to develop these problems. There must be some pre-existing damage to either your kidneys, liver, or your metabolism in some way that you're not able to process or deal with these oxalates like you should. And one aspect of that is in your gut, if you have dysbiosis, if you have a lack of certain microbes, especially the lactobacillus microbes, okay, and there's quite a few different ones, you may have a big problem degrading or breaking down oxalates in the intestine, and then they get reabsorbed into the blood, and they end up in your kidneys. But you can also have a problem with the kidneys from having diabetes, prediabetes, insulin resistance, years of eating carbohydrates, etc., etc. So if the kidneys or liver is damaged, you may have a problem dealing with oxalates. And many people that go on the ketogenic diet and they start adapting to fat burning and ketones get rid of their problem with oxalates. But not everyone. So I'm going to give you a list of very important things that I think could really help you just by understanding this. Number one, of course, I would limit the foods high in oxalates, especially the almonds, peanuts, chocolate, spinach, the beet tops. But if you do have these foods, if you add some cheese with the calcium, that calcium will bind to the oxalates in the intestines and prevent the absorption into the blood and into the kidneys. So that's one way that you can kind of lower the amount of oxalate damage to the kidneys. Now, soy, which I never recommend consuming, does have a good amount of oxalates, but it also has a lot of phytates, which tend to minimize the effect. But of course, phytates will prevent the absorption of zinc and other minerals, so that gives you a whole set of other problems. Number one thing I would recommend is find a probiotic with a mixture of all the lactobacillus microbes. Those are lactic acid bacteria that actually help produce oxalates. But the next thing that's very, very important is maintaining higher levels of magnesium, okay, and citrates. Both of those are really, really important in weakening the bond between calcium and the oxalates. But I think magnesium does it in a bigger way. I just released a video on magnesium, and I talked about what foods are high in magnesium. But if you really look at what it's going to take to get your magnesium from foods, you're going to find out it's not as easy as you might think. So I will put that link down below. It's a very important video. So you may want to take a magnesium glycinate supplement to help lower the risk of oxalates ending up in your kidneys. The other thing with the citrates is I would make sure that I would consume like maybe a lemon a day or lemon juice, put some water in there, maybe a couple drops of stevia, electrolyte powder, and I'll blend the entire lemon with water and drink that down. Other times I don't have lemon, so I'll just put some lemon juice in my apple cider vinegar drink and I'll drink that down. But the citrates are very, very important. Now the other really important thing is vitamin D. Vitamin D increases the absorption of calcium by 20 times in the intestines, which is going to help you take that calcium, make it more available to be able to bind with the oxalates in the gut so it doesn't end up in the kidney as well. Now, I just want to mention a problem that a lot of people have with vitamin D. I did some DNA testing. I think it might have been 20-some-odd people I tested with the DNA, and every single one of them had a problem with vitamin D genetically. Whether it's converting vitamin D or absorption of vitamin D or the vitamin D receptor, 100% of those people had a problem genetically. And the name for that is a vitamin D polymorphism, which is a genetic issue dealing with vitamin D. And a vitamin D receptor polymorphism is a bioindicator of calcium oxalate stones, which is interesting. So in other words, there's a very high correlation between people that have stones and have a problem with vitamin D, probably because of the calcium absorption problem. So in addition to taking the probiotic with the lactic acid bacteria, lactobacillus, and the magnesium and the lemons, I would also recommend vitamin D, probably at least 10,000 IUs every single day. And then on top of all that, I would recommend consuming minimally 2.5 liters of fluid every single day, just to keep your urine diluted enough so you don't have any type of super concentration or consolidating effect of that calcium binding with that oxalate. If you keep your urine diluted, then you won't get a kidney stone. Now, because of the censoring and the suppressing of the algorithms on YouTube, it's becoming more difficult to find my content. And there's a lot of content that I cannot put on YouTube, unfortunately. So to make sure you have full access of all my information, go to drberg.com and subscribe to my newsletter by clicking the link down below in the description. I will see you on the other side. Now, since magnesium is so important for so many things, if you have not seen my video related to magnesium and getting it from Foods, you should probably check it out. I put it up right here.
Eggs, and here's what happened. Did you know you can help those struggling with infertility and receive up to $48,000?
Day 646. Today there is a lot of good news. Over the last week, Ukrainian secret services reportedly conducted a series of coordinated attacks on dozens of Russian military objects of strategic significance. The first target became one of the two major railway lines between Russia and China. Recently, Russian military officials met with Chinese and North Korean leaders and arranged military supplies. Shortly after that, Russians received thousands of containers with unknown cargo from these countries. The goal was to destroy this strategic connection and undermine the supplies of weapons to Russia, which is especially important right now as Russians are on the offensive. The connection was paralyzed by a massive explosion that happened inside the Severomuysky tunnel. Several Ukrainian outlets reported that Ukrainian intelligence sources stated that four explosive devices detonated on the train with 50 cars carrying diesel and aviation fuel. The explosion caused a chain reaction, and at least 16 containers with fuel exploded in total. The accident rendered the tunnel completely unusable, at least in the short to medium term. As usual, Russian officials claimed that the incident happened due to an electric short circuit. The second target became the
Ukrainian
second
special
major
forces.
Railway line between Russia and China. This was basically the backup line. The connection was cut off also by an explosion on the train that was transporting fuel. Ukrainian sources reported that six fuel tanks were blown up while the train was on the 35-meter-tall bridge. In the aftermath of both attacks, Russians lost the ability to import military cargo from North Korea and China because they almost exclusively relied on railways. The third target became a warehouse with Iranian kamikaze drones in Bryansk. The warehouse was struck during the Ukrainian drone strike on Russian military objects. Local residents filmed the moment of this strike, and as can be seen, multiple drones managed to hit the facilities. Later, Russian sources confirmed the destruction of the warehouses. Russian military analysts complained about the inability of Russia's air defense to protect military objects of strategic significance. The fourth target became a Russian airfield in Crimea. Ukrainian Air Force reportedly conducted a combined strike, and by engaging various types of drones and missiles, including Storm Shadow missiles, managed to penetrate the Russian air defense and strike the airfield in Saki. Ukrainian sources reported that this is the place of deployment of the Russian 43rd Aviation Regiment, which incurred up to 30 losses in personnel in the aftermath of the strike. So far, the information regarding the losses of equipment is unknown. The fifth target became the Russian aviation factory in Smolensk. Local residents filmed the aftermath of an explosion in the factory, confirming the damage. Later, Ukrainian intelligence confirmed that this was a special operation conducted by the Ukrainian spies. The sixth target became another Russian factory. This time, it was the tractor factory in Chelyabinsk. Local residents managed to catch the moment of the explosion on camera. Russian sources once again claimed that the fire was caused by an electrical short circuit. However, these claims were not taken seriously even in the Russian media space, especially in the light of other suspicious incidents throughout the country. In fact, many fires also broke out in the markets and shopping centers in the centers of the biggest cities, like Moscow, St. Petersburg, and Rostov. The area of some of the fires reached more than 4,000 square meters. Russian city officials all stated that the incidents in their cities happened as a result of an electrical short circuit. Overall, the Ukrainian secret services coordinated operations successfully targeted key infrastructural points, notably disrupting the flow of military supplies from allies like China and North Korea and inflicting substantial damage on Russian military capabilities. The destruction of major railway connections, a drone warehouse, an airfield, and factories not only hampers the Russian military efforts, but also signifies the reach and effectiveness of Ukrainian intelligence and military operations. In light of the Christmas season, I am pleased to announce an exclusive sale on our dual flag collection. Right now, you can get our best-selling items with dual flags at substantial 20-30% discounts. If you would like to show your solidarity with our dual flags and support my work, now is an ideal opportunity to make a purchase. So check out the link in the description.
Whoa, you don't want to desecrate two flags.
Your support is greatly appreciated.
Your health is your biggest asset. Find Anthem Blue
Cross. I mean, if you design some pins. Did I post this yet?
Pneumonia outbreaks hit U.S. states, while similar outbreaks overwhelm hospitals in China. Are the outbreaks connected? The White House enhancing a host of supply chains, looking to cut China reliance on EVs, agriculture, and medicine. Montana's first-in-the-nation TikTok ban blocked by a federal judge. Why didn't the rule stick?
Sure.
And despite the strike down, is the social media platform really safe? A look at fresh testimony from Capitol Hill on TikTok and its risks. What do you think? Let us know below and subscribe if you haven't already.
Welcome to China in Focus. I'm Tiffany Meyer. A surge in child illness cases hitting the U.S. That's as pediatric pneumonia outbreaks rip through China, overwhelming hospitals across the country. The hotspots here in the U.S., Ohio, and Massachusetts. The Buckeye State recording over 140 cases in one county. No deaths have been reported. Massachusetts also saw a large uptick in child pneumonia cases. Is the outbreak linked to China? Ohio's Warren County saying so far there's no evidence that the local outbreak is connected to other international outbreaks. Officials also don't believe a new virus is behind the recent spike, adding it's...
This is the SARS virus. The thing that that happened was the Omicron family of the virus mutated. It's like 3 or 4 months back, maybe 4 or 5 months back. It's been a minute. It was like 3 to 5 months back within that time frame. The news had dropped that, well, among the scientific community, that essentially the SARS virus has complete evasion and complete escape properties in its mutation. So now humans, I kept thinking like, well, the virus has essentially escape properties, then how are we going to ever kind of grab the virus to make sure we know it's a virus? And I was like, well, if we lose the ability to detect it and our bodies lose the ability to fight against it, yeah, definitely, the first kind of wave of people that will suffer will be, well, I guarantee you, older folks are already dying, but it's the fact that children are dying that makes it much more prevalent. For example, if the elderly are dying together, so if you're like 85 and up, 75 up, 65 up, you're dying as a couple, or you might die solo, and the virus will take you. But for a child, though, will, since they have a fledgling immune system that's developing, they're not 10 years old or 12 years old, they're under 10, they're susceptible, especially if they're under 8 years old, they're more susceptible to the virus. If they're under 8, if they're at 8, then they have a percentage chance of having a slightly more, you know, developed immune system. By 10, hopefully the immune system is there, but by 12 years old, most children, the immune system is now intact. So it's now children that are 8 and under, 10 and under, give or take, that are succumbing to this kind of suffering, falling under the guise of the virus, as the virus kids propagate, fletchate, and spread. The kind of two groups is basically, it is kind of 85 and up and 8 and under, but it's almost like 10 and under and 65 and older. But luckily enough, if you're in your 70s and you have the right kind of, you know, diet, you're vaccinated and boosted, you take some safety precautions, you should be able to eliminate most risk. There'll still be risk, but I still would say the vast majority of your risk can be mitigated versus, man, a 10-year-old kid just doesn't know. 10-year-old kid, you're hoping the parents understand, you're hoping if children under 10 years old are wearing masks to protect themselves so they don't get infected with SARS virus will weaken a person's immune system, making it more acceptable to other viruses. That's why you're seeing other outbreaks of other diseases or other viruses, because other bacterial infections or fungi infections, because the SARS virus itself will destroy and weaken your immune system. And so it's definitely not good. This is like the first signs, essentially. But like, the thing I'm getting at is that old people are going to be dying across the United States, but you're not really... Only the family's going to grieve, the local community's going to grieve. But the moment you have, like, giant red flags and alarm bells are going off because you have waves of children being infected. So,
respiratory illnesses
in the United States. It's already happening in China. All the children hospitals are overwhelmed.
To
but
spread
it's,
during this time of year.
Yeah.
Ohio is further investigating the cause. Physicians in Western
kids don't know. They go to school. They're not wearing the mask. They don't understand what's happening. The adults have to do everything
RSV
they can to protect them.
RSV is a respiratory virus that kills over 10,000 Americans per year. Outside the U.S., Denmark, Sweden, and Switzerland are also grappling with surges in pneumonia cases. The outbreak is putting lawmakers on high alert. 5 Republican lawmakers urging the Biden administration to impose travel bans. Leading lawmaker Senator Marco Rubio saying Washington should immediately restrict travel between the U.S. and China. In contrast, Taiwan authorities are putting airports on watch, advising the elderly, young, and those with poor immunity to avoid going to China. Meanwhile, Chinese authorities remain opaque about the surge. Officials told the World Health Organization that the surge in pneumonia cases isn't overwhelming hospitals. But citizens across China are telling NTD a different story.
Oh, wait.
It takes
hold on. I gotta get her breakfast. 6 a.m. This is what she eats. What's San Antonio doing?
But if you don't kill the person, then you don't get dog harvested. Like,
I might go buy some chai and get a bagel. 6 a.m. A lot of cafes open up around this time.
This is a mess about Gap again. This is fucking good, man. Captain Frump, thank you so much for your prime. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I really appreciate the support. I hope you enjoy your stay. Now you get my swallow sad emote that you can spam when I lose my next game, so... Lucky you, lucky you. But yeah, I really appreciate it, man. Welcome, welcome. I will run ads 1.5 minutes, I know. Fucking blows. It's so you don't get them during the game. I know, fucking blows. But it is what it is, right? Chum. Give me 1 sec, I need to... How do I say this name? Chum... Fuckus? Chumfu? Juice? Chumfu juice? Chumfu juice. That's what I'm gonna say. I'm sorry if I'm not saying it properly. It might be completely wrong. it'd be nice if you can write how I'm supposed to pronounce it. But yeah, thank you so much for your prime, man. I really appreciate it. Please don't try to read it. It's a problem for many. Chum? That works, thank you. Okay, nice, nice. Okay, just let me know what you want to be called. I really appreciate the support, man. I hope you enjoy your stay. Dude, that name is not easy. I'll be honest. Chumpa Juice? Is that fine? And I'm already bad with names, so yeah, that went somewhere. I'm not gonna say Brandon's easy, but I saw Poe that played when Autoflow Jungle, it was definitely a jungle gap. I think the champ is pretty easy to learn, yeah. The main thing with Brand is understanding that you probably lose almost everyone you won early game, and you kind of have to play scared. And you also have to understand that your champ farms super quickly, which means you should prioritize killing your camps. There are times where you should not kill your camps because there's stuff to do on the map, but generally speaking, getting in the habit of just killing camps is really big on Brand. Because as you're watching, right, like I'm really like one-tapping camps, which means like, if my teammates can just wait that like 10-15 seconds extra, I'll be up like two camps in enemy jungle instantly, right? So it's kind of like getting in the mindset of farming a lot, but also understanding that it's not always the right thing to farm. You also have to be active on the map, and sometimes you should not be farming that extra jungle camp. Is it play on dumb fuck cues? It's a play on words involving my native language. Oh. Interesting. I love involving like native language kind of stuff. That's pog. All right, let's get some WoW in here in the queue time. Why not? Zombie skin is a bit pay to win because of the hand movements hiding the cast of some of these abilities. Is it still like that, Talon? If it's still like that, I might have to pay to win. You know what I'm saying? Back to the real game. Oh, it's still like that? Wow, I didn't even know that. You, is that classic? What's your problem, chap? Come 1v1 me. Small Tauren is fucking ready for anything. I need to make a... Okay, I forgot how...
I think I'm gonna level it, obviously. Alrighty. No, I didn't pick my team yet, I will do it later.
Oh, Ari Sock is still... She said, don't know, I was supposed to put... Oh, yeah.
Ever to get a doctor's appointment. Staff in other departments went to support the pediatric department. Many patients just sit on stools in the hallway for 3 or 4 days until it's their turn to visit the pediatrician's office.
Hospitals are overflowing. Emergency care can only give you prescriptions with enough medication for 1 day. After that, you have to get in line again for 8, 9, or even 12 hours.
Chinese officials also changed their narrative about what's driving the outbreak. Authorities at first said it was mycoplasma pneumonia, later blaming it on multiple viruses. But a virologist told NTD that a new COVID-19 variant could also be a possibility.
Some patients' blood oxygen levels have dropped to 90% once they do check-ins at the hospital. This is very typical of COVID-19 infections.
She said mycoplasma and other bacteria or viruses wouldn't be enough to launch such a quick spread across the country, but that COVID-19 could. Ultimately, data is needed to determine what's driving the outbreak. Beijing is keeping information from inside the country quiet. The White House is looking to shore up resources. Biden announced the launch of a Supply Chain Resilience Council Monday.
With the launch of a new Council on Supply Chain Resilience, I'm charging this group to ensure that our supply chains remain secure, diversified, resilient, and do all and into the future.
The latest move seeks to enhance American supply chains based on guidance issued Friday. It will curb electric car imports containing Chinese components like EV batteries. Under the new rule, auto buyers hoping to claim the full federal tax credit could receive up to $7,500. But they won't get the money if the cars they're buying are made with parts from foreign entities of concern. On top of China, that means North Korea, Russia, and Iran. The rule kicks off next month and aims to stabilize supply chains by cutting reliance on China. In the meantime, U.S. automakers are racing to fortify their own battery production plants. Worth noting, EVs are a hot topic on Biden's re-election platform. He's pushing for more electric cars on American roads to help achieve his climate ambitions. The main goal, to cut greenhouse gas emissions in half by 2030. Beyond automaking, medicine and agriculture are on Biden's radar too. The president invoked the Cold War era Defense Production Act earlier this week to spur manufacturing investment for medical supplies. China has been a main source for medical manufacturing due to low production costs. During the COVID-19 pandemic, the U.S. purchased both medicines and face masks from the country. What's more, the White House is also looking to strengthen food supply chains. The U.S. Department of Agriculture is investing nearly $200 million to widen markets for farmers and reduce food costs for consumers. The federal government is channeling the aid into six programs overseeing around 200 projects across the U.S. Montana's first-in-the-nation ban on TikTok was blocked on Thursday. A U.S. district judge says it's unconstitutional and oversteps state power. Under the law, the China-owned app would be outlawed from operating within state lines, with potential fines of $10,000 per day. Montana's governor signed it into law in May, saying it was necessary to protect Montana's residents' data from the Chinese Communist Party. A TikTok spokesman said the company was pleased that the judge, quote, rejected this unconstitutional law. The ban was set to take effect on January 1st. More than half of U.S. states and the federal government have banned TikTok on official devices. Debate over the Chinese Communist Party's rising threat taking center stage in Washington. Lawmakers heard new testimony on Capitol Hill about U.S.'s interests they say are under attack. NTD's Daniel Monahan has the highlights.
The Select Committee on the Chinese Communist Party Chairman Mike Gallagher warned about TikTok becoming a primary news source for younger generations, with their worldviews potentially being shaped by the CCP.
It would be as if in 1962, at the height of the Cuban Missile Crisis, we allowed Pravda and the KGB to purchase the New York Times, the Washington Post, ABC, and NBC, and that probably understates the scope of the problem.
Gallagher says there's clear evidence that parent company ByteDance has done the Communist Party's bidding. He discussed how the CCP forced ByteDance to shut down its news platform because it went against its core socialist values.
And in a groveling self-criticism, the founder of ByteDance apologized for failing to respect socialist core values and deviating from public opinion guidance and failing to realize that socialist core values are the prerequisite to technology. Following this, ByteDance announced a new strategy to hire 4,000 extra censors and integrate socialist core values into its technology.
Representative Seth Moulton also touched on the online threat of the CCP.
But today, China is attacking our businesses, our citizens, our kids, through the internet every single day.
Former State Department official Miles Yu says the CCP is strongly influencing Chinese citizens abroad through buying major media outlets.
Hundreds of TV stations, newspapers, magazines overseas, outside of China, almost all of them are now bought by the Chinese Communist Party. There's a recent study indicated that the only network that is not really controlled by the Chinese Communist Party is the Falun Gong-related media outlets.
Congresswoman Michelle Steele highlighted the problem with universities taking CCP money.
UC Berkeley received $220 million from CCP, never reported.
Miles Yu also touched on what he views as the corrupt relationship of prestigious universities like Harvard with the CCP.
They conduct a survey on behalf of the Chinese government to prove that 93% of Chinese people support the Chinese Communist Party. So use Harvard's prestige to support the Chinese propaganda.
Yu says Harvard didn't even do their own research. Instead, subcontracting a Chinese company in Beijing to do it. Yu discusses what the CCP most fears about America.
It doesn't matter which party is in charge, Democrats or Republican. It's not a policy per se. It's the very existence of the United States that could inspire Chinese people. That's what they fear about most.
Testimony was also heard on the CCP's infiltration of sensitive infrastructure.
For all the ports, same thing too. They're controlling our trains, and they're controlling data tracking systems.
While Congressman Gallagher is calling on the Biden administration to investigate the Chinese drone company Autel Robotics, Gallagher says Autel is openly affiliated with the People's Liberation Army.
The congressman says law enforcement and state and local governments are purchasing and operating Autel drones, potentially exposing sensitive data across the country. Daniel Monahan, NTD News.
North Korean leader Kim Jong-un calling for the nation's military readiness against enemies. That's as the U.S. slaps new sanctions on Pyongyang following its spy satellite launch last week. Here's more.
Photographs released by the KCNA news agency showed Kim visiting the Air Force headquarters on Thursday. It said he also wrote out operational strategic guidelines to improve the military's readiness and war capabilities. On Thursday, the U.S. unveiled new sanctions targeting foreign-based agents it accused of helping Pyongyang evade other sanctions. Their U.S. assets will be frozen and Americans barred from dealing with them. In a statement, the U.S. Treasury Department said the joint efforts with Australia, Japan, and South Korea, quote, reflect our collective commitment to contesting Pyongyang's illicit and destabilizing activities. The Treasury also sanctioned cyber espionage group Kintsugi, accusing it of gathering intelligence to support the North's strategic and nuclear ambitions. Meanwhile, Seoul said on Friday it had blacklisted 11 North Koreans for the involvement in their country's satellite and missile development, banning them from any financial transactions.
The disingenuous DPRK claim.
Earlier this week, U.S. and North Korean diplomats had a rare direct public exchange at a U.N. Security Council meeting, with both arguing their country's military activities are defensive. North Korea's UN mission in New York did not immediately respond to a request for comment on the latest sanctions.
Shifting gears, next we have a round of updates from Asia and Oceania, tensions in the South China Sea. The Philippines opened a new Coast Guard monitoring base Friday on an island in the South China Sea. That's to watch Chinese vessels in the contested waters. Face-offs between Chinese and Philippine ships have intensified this year. At the new base's opening ceremony, a Philippine official called the actions of Chinese ships, quote, pure bullying. The Philippines decided this year to allow an expansion of the U.S. military presence in the country. It also recently launched joint sea and air patrols with the U.S. and Australia. A new era for Taiwan's air defense. The Taiwanese Air Force is saying goodbye to one of its oldest fighter jets, American-made F-5s, also known as Tigers. Replacing the aircraft are new, domestically made advanced jet trainers. Because the jets are locally made, Taiwan can both cut costs and grow its domestic defense industry. Taiwan's Air Force is under immense pressure as it scrambles regularly to intercept Chinese warplanes flying near the country. But that's not all. An exclusive report from Reuters says the Chinese regime is sponsoring cheap trips to China for hundreds of Taiwanese politicians ahead of key elections. China is reportedly attempting to sway voters toward candidates seeking closer ties with the regime. Taiwanese law forbids election campaigns from receiving funds from external hostile forces, such as China. Prosecutors this week are investigating 22 people in connection with the interference. China said Thursday it has started to review its tariffs on Australian wine. Beijing imposed sanctions on Australian wine, barley, and coal in 2020. That's as their ties soured over Canberra's push for an independent COVID-19 origin probe. The visit of Australia's Prime Minister Anthony Albanese earlier this month marked the resumption of an annual leaders' meeting after a four-year hiatus. China has been a major market for Australia in a range of goods, including coal, wine, beef, barley, and lobster. How important is the Arctic to U.S. security? The House Homeland Security Committee is holding a hearing to delve into the issue. Watch.
We all know, and you mentioned it, Mr. Chairman, we are in a new era of authoritarian aggression led by the dictators Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping. They are running hostile regimes that seek to control access to the Arctic region and, importantly and dangerously, are increasingly working together in the Arctic. Alaska's proximity to both Russia and China requires that my state play a vital role in securing America's interests in the Arctic.
Senator Dan Sullivan of Alaska was one of the witnesses who testified. He stressed the vital importance of his state to U.S. homeland security in the Arctic. The senator compared the strength of Russian and Chinese forces in the region to that of the U.S. He also highlighted recent joint military activities by China and Russia near Alaska. Sullivan called for more funding for Alaska's defense infrastructure and urged Congress to take seriously the role that his state plays in defending the Arctic.
Next, headlines from across the pond. The UK is next in line to lose its only giant panda bears. The pair will soon depart from Edinburgh Zoo after calling Scotland's capital home for the past 12 years. The bamboo-loving bears are considered a type of soft diplomacy for Beijing. The Chinese regime keeps custody of the animals, loaning them out as rewards and withholding them as punishment. Washington's National Zoo returned its three pandas last month, after Beijing stayed quiet on attempts to renew the contract. San Diego and Memphis, Tennessee waived similar farewells. Atlanta is the last American zoo still caring for the creatures through next year. Beijing is believed to be pulling pandas home amid rising tensions with the West. The leader Xi Jinping noted China was ready to continue loaning the bears to the U.S. during his recent visit to California. On the science front, British lawmakers are calling on the country's top data regulator to launch a new investigation. According to letters, they're concerned about Chinese genetics company BGI. That's after reports accuse the company of using it to research population traits alongside the Chinese military. Washington already blacklisted BGI over human rights allegations that it helped Beijing surveil minority groups. Based on a letter, Britain's regulator says there isn't enough evidence to investigate. That's all for today's China in Focus on YouTube. We're now sharing a shortened version of our program here after being demonetized for more than 2 years. If you'd like to support us, subscribe to our partner platform, Epic TV, where you can watch our full episodes. Or consider donating. Find us at donorbox.org/China-in-focus. Here's what to look out for in our second half, a battle over green energy. Starting next year, the U.S. Treasury Department will restrict tax incentives for American electric battery plants. That's if their product contains certain components from China or any other, quote, foreign entity of concern. But some critical minerals will be exempt from the new rule. Will the action help secure the critical EV supply chain at home? To discuss, we sat down with Kelly Sloan, Senior Fellow in Energy and Environment at the Centennial Institute. Thanks.
So we're probably going to have to set up there soon.
Oh, she got Mountain Dew sponsoring. Congrats. That's cool. I'm surprised there's not a... a Mountain Dew badge or something? Icon?
Oh, I don't have Flash anymore. He was worried about that orb being there. Should have paid more attention. Always oom. This is true. I am always oom.
Nice. Looks like GG.
Can I go back, please? This is all Mocha. I'm doing good work, guys.
Phew. And no one died. Guys, our team, we're just too good.
Looks like
also,
a win.
Rel always goes in when I need them to. It's just chef's kiss. Ooh, I got blue buff. Nice. Don't mind if I do. I kind of need this. The way I use my mana, like it's like running water. Yeah. Walk into us, Samira. I dare you. I have full confidence my team will back me up. Uh-oh. Will they make it out? Yeah, they will. Oh my god, I do so much damage. It's so nice.
Oh, nice. She's going, Poetic Cheer. Or... Oh,
oh,
that's,
Is
she okay?
I trolled. I should not have been in front like that. I saw the opportunity for an amazing ultimate and I just kept on looking forward and, faded my entire team. XP. Oh, but you know, Nocturne is pushing Inhib. He's gonna get an Inhib for this. Oh. Yeah, dang.
Oh.
Oh, that I think he used his dash. All good. I thought I had ult, and I was like, huh, why is my ult not going off? I'm like in between two units right now. Off of this? What do we do?
Ah, she.
No! Oh my god, that was so awesome. We carried only because of the rel. I got S! Let's go! We're doing it.
Yay. What is that banner? What the heck?
My MMR is super bad because, I went on like a 20 game loss streak pretty much. King lost streak. Well, I love that for you. I was just getting really unlucky with my team. And before you guys laugh at that excuse, it's like, I swear. It's one thing to lose lane, but then when all lanes are losing, it's just, it feels so worried. You find that one support you can climb really hard. It was true. You love when people ask you to swap just for them to play their one trick.
Yeah.
Fortune doesn't fade. I love it. Because to me, it's important that we win, right? And if they're going to play what they're most comfortable with, that's higher chances, no? I do understand the frustration behind like the whole one trick. Because it's like, oh yeah, like, what if it's not good into the comp? What if it's XYZ? I get it. But I promise I can do it. Miss Fortune's ulti is very game-changing. Guys, it's only 6:43 a.m. and I'm already sad that I have to go around like 5 p.m. But I'll come back. Cleaners are very shy. They don't want me to go live while they're cleaning, which is understandable. Belveth only? Jesus, Belveth actually is so strong. I don't know if they nerfed her, but I remember playing with or against a Belveth every other game at some point, and they were so scary. Lost every time. Wait, how did it turn off? I think it has auto turn off. Heat me up, Blanky. I mean, these ranks, I guess, don't really matter. If MF was banned, what ADC would you use? I've grown a liking to Jinx. You're not a Realm, you're Senna main. Ah, well,
Well, your rel is insane. Your Senna is definitely, I'm sure, really, really good too. But I do think in low elo, if you know how to play a tank properly, it's just, it's so suppressing. Because typically in low elo, I don't know what's happening here because they are actually playing tanks. But my other games, everyone just picks AP support for pure damage, and other lanes just go assassin mode, no tanks, no initiation. I'm crying. Mid is free kills. Oh. My other games, everyone just picks AP support for pure damage, and other lanes just go assassin mode, no tank, no initiation. I'm crying. Damn, if our whole team was there, I think that Victor would have died. Well, she did say mid was free. Maybe mechanically they're a little bit more good. But how would you know? Maybe they played against them? Words? Wow. Yeah, actually, supports that know how to focus warding, or just in general, like, like that's already miles ahead of what I expect from this elo. Usually this elo, they don't ever ward. Are they even called pinks anymore? That's how old they
are. Alright, you look like the cat looks like she wants to sleep.
The red wards used to be pink. They were so cute. I actually cosplayed a pink ward before. So freaking hard. Okay. I see how it's gonna be. Oh god, that was close. Okay. Huge. Biscuits. I love me cookies. Here's the thrush.
stepped on a trap. My fault. Oh, God.
Thrash hooks you. Oh, boy, hooked rail.
Huge!
Trouble with the weapon.
Oh, my God. This rail is insane. Okay, I don't. They might dive me here. Oh, they won't. I didn't miss that cannon. A whole new world. Bruh.
Take a picture of the cat.
No. Oh, he stole it. That's why. Oh my God, I didn't see that. Oh my gosh, I'm blind. Oh my gosh, our Warwick is a hero.
She's not camera. She's like super relaxed.
Caitlin. Feels good. Good enough for me.
Is Aria? Ain't no way she's watching my stream.
This is like the worst I've ever done with farming in a while, but that's okay. It's been very scrappy, you know, and I have a 3 assists. We're doing good.
I am a diamond support. I could easily hop on my one alternate account that I don't play on. Like, I have my main account that I play League of Legends on, and then I have like one alternative account, like second account that like I have just in case, but like I don't ever use it. I could hop on that, probably help Ari in the future, maybe.
Oh my. Maybe the 200 hertz
is
a bit too I'm kidding. Actually, I'm gonna up my quality after. I think I'm still playing on low quality settings. I think so. Let's try on high in a sec.
I thought Rel had a play. I thought Rel was trying to. Nice. Let's kick you.
I do more than you, Caitlin. I would be careful.
That's good movement from Aria.
Some ganks right now.
Nice. Auto. I guess that'd be too risky.
I played that a little wrong, but that's okay. We still got the kill on the person that matters.
Auto. Interesting that Arya's not auto attacking. Because you really just want to get rid of this wave and recall. So that the faster this wave crashes, the more CS that Caitlyn loses.
And Gwen is popping off. Let's go.
But, she's not. There we go. And just recall. Because actually, she has 1,000 goals. Like, the faster you get back. Oh, you gotta kill this wave now. You have to kill this wave now. Because you see, her wife's going to be in a bad spot. So like, you have to destroy. Oh, they don't understand. So yeah, see, either back now to catch this wave, or you crash it because they're staggered deaths. So. Ain't no way Caitlyn just what?
Caitlyn just ate a bunch of my autos in queue, but okay. Yeah.
You should be able to cut her off and keep going. Oh, keep going, keep going, keep going. Oh, they should have chased. They're not letting back. That's where you throw away your minions because you want to catch them. You want to pursue them. You want to chase the Caitlyn if they're just trying to run away. Wait, cannon? Where are we throwing away cannon? Why are we throwing away cannon right now? What? We're throwing away XP and gold to hopefully get assist or kill. Oh, nice. They got him. But she didn't need to use all. Alright, I should get there in time.
I need all that, but whatever.
Yeah. Why is the top runner even typing? I don't ever want to see my top laners type. I'm playing League of Legends. The top laners. Like, what? Gwen, you're not even helping take Dragon. Why is Gwen even talking? Like, what? I'd mute that top laner in an instant. Like, what? The moment a laner just says something dumb, they're muted in my game. Like, I don't. I don't need time for that nonsense. I think you're going to auto. Oh, that was a cue. Wait, am I?
He doesn't even attempt. Interesting.
Are you okay?
Oh god, I'm trolling.
Wait, what? She's not queuing back? I don't understand.
Let's give it a little bit more time.
Yeah, see, like when Ro got queued, I thought she was gonna queue the Thresh. Oh. Nice, that's good queue. Oh, it's good Ro. And then, wait, why are we firing though?
No, walk back into it. No.
Oh no. She had a Q, but she didn't click it. That was an opportunity for a trade kill. Arya will get it in time. She kind of rushed it.
Higher up. That is okay. I shouldn't have chicken. I shouldn't have been so far back. I should have moved up with Rel and, if anything, play on the left side. Now I know.
Well, in that instance, I think you let Rel die. You stay 2-1-4, and then you soak the next wave. And then recall. But the enemy Thresh has 2 kills, so kind of okay-ish. Oh, y'all gotta run.
Okay.
Might has it. Oh. Okay, auto. Oh, if she still had ult from. Oh,
kinda
my
strong.
Goodness. If she still had ult, that's
I would go in.
That would have been a double kill. Yeah.
Oh my god, I ate that Caitlyn Q.
Oh, one Q on the Thresh. Oh, nice. Warwick's here. Yeah, he got some. Oh, go. Go. If he's going. Oh, no. Oh, she's going. Dude, team. What are they doing? If the team just... Wow. Oh, she's dead now. But if the team is there, Lasandra doesn't die.
So scrappy. Okay, now we take tower. It's going up next. Oh no, he's gonna get it before us. Oh, it's okay.
Okay.
Oh yeah, I can change to the bunny skin after. I just changed it because I remember my 20 game loss streak pretty much. And I was like, oh, maybe it's the skin.
Certain skins do change. Certain skins do change the VFX and animation of a champion.
One of the best, like, sound effects.
A few pros have talked about it. They feel like some skins are... Some skins can actually hide the VFX animation of your champion, which is like a huge advantage. It's like Corki's like that. There's like a certain skin on Corki where it like hides his R. It makes a smaller animation. But the hitbox is still the same. And I'm trying to remember which Corki is it. It's a Corki where it looks like he's like on a warplane or something like that, I think. The Corki on a warplane changes his VFX. Just one champion, for example. Other champions like that too. Like Lucian has that with the Double have talked about it with the Lucian, Project Lucian, I think. Just the way the animations are, he says they're like they're cleaner, and because they're cleaner, he can animation cancel faster. It's like much more readable. Stuff like that. For him, versus players that want to hide their abilities, or players that want to be able to like have a much more smoother walking and attacking animation, all that. Echo's like that. I think Echo on his ultimate skin, the one he just got, changed his VFX and animation or something like that. I didn't get it because the Echo ultimate is like a prestige Star Guardian Echo or something like that. Changes just kind of like how he swings and fights and launches his ability. Oh, that looks like the freest ult in the world. Oh my. Team's dead. Oh no.
Kind of disgusting.
I feel like that should have been better. It was a good ult, but just something with the team, like, just not. Oh, Lasandra wasn't there.
Oh, I didn't have Collector. Oof.
Lasandra wasn't there. That's fine.
If I had Collector, oh my god.
Yeah, probably triple kill if she had Collector.
We would have all melted.
I wonder if she's tactically repositioning with the untargetable. I have to watch it again. How did he get away? What? The fear and the stun? I was gonna say, like, what? Ain't no way. Ain't no way you getting away. Like, it's a Rell and a Warwick. He's not running the skin on Rell. Interesting, Jimmy Grimm. Oh, it's probably all the counter or something.
There's no minions. Oh, nice. Oh,
wait, no. He said Shelly. They're both in the same elo. Yeah, they're good. Auto. Got an auto attack. Got a, just not enough auto attacks are being weaved in. Oh no. Oh, good dodge. Oh, but Graves has the dash.
How much we can do there. He has a little bit of armor, just a little bit. But I should still build this, I think. It's good.
Oh, she needs boots. Like, I was like, wait, what? For 20 minutes into the match? Or 20 minutes into the match and she didn't go boots.
Are you talking about my 20 game loss streak? If you're talking about this game, I'm not losing hard at all. They're just perma grouped right now.
The rel was already super toxic earlier. I would have already muted them all again. She has all chat on? That's bold. I wouldn't.
Never mind. I thought they were gonna be Baron.
I would never hear anything from the enemy. Oh wait, enemy team 737 Graves 616 Shen. Ooh, I could play Shen top. I also guarantee that the Lissandra is probably also gaslighting too, and the vision score sucks. What's Lissandra's vision score? There's a 7 vision score, bro. Ain't no way the Lissandra is this depth. Where they're like their 7 vision score like complain. Oh my god, that means they haven't placed any of their wards. Like, because even an average mid laner just placing wards has more than 7 vision, which means this dude is even placing wards. Like, dude, what? Dude, that's cognitive dissonance. Thank God, the distance is unreal. But she's not. Is that a sigh of relief?
Yeah, I think like the Gwen had a really good lead. But the issue now is that they're pretty much perma grouped. So they're always going to win these like skirmishes that we're finding.
Yeah, the enemy team is 5v4ing. And the Gwen keeps like split pushing. I can't see the map, so I also can't help. I can tell you what the enemy's gonna do before they do it. 100% of the time. Also, the mid laner can't be 3 and 7. Oh, she's not attack move clicking. That's why. I thought something was just kind of like interesting. Auto. You gotta auto. Cause you have to let that. Ah, they're coming. Yeah, Shen can ult in, and also Shen was already, like, even just being static, you know, just fighting with his team. I know where Gwen thought, playing Hero Ball, playing Hero League, Gon Solo was going to win the game. Like, what? Nice. Her lethality does cut through their armor. So they have a Thresh and a Shen. Should be able to poke them down. But Shen was 616. He didn't do jack. Gwen didn't do anything. Like, Gren, like, what? Shen was 6 kills, 1 dead, 6 assists. The freaking Gwen didn't do nothing. What? Now Shen is 728 with a 7 KDA. Like,
everything's kind of pushed. I don't know where to go. Yeah, they play very, like, close-knit. As rough as that, like, Gwen went damage while Shen is going full tank, so late game is going to be a little hard. Warwick went damage too. Oh my god, he's just chasing him. Played my all. Don't know if that was the right play. Warwick going in, and then we also didn't have full vision. Caitlyn being on the other side, and that Thresh played me during my ult was too good. I think maybe I need Edge of Night. Caught it and die. Okay, that's good. Huge. We won those. See, we did it. We did it, team. It's possible. Possible. Come on.
something light. They lined up for me, practically. Can they win off that? Maybe. Maybe off the dubskis. If I was up, maybe we could do that. Maybe we could do that again. Yeah, three showed bots. So.
I should go to sleep. Short sleep like 2 or 3 hours ago. So 10 a.m. is it gonna be Washington, Michigan, Alabama, and Texas? Did the committee just kick out Florida State? That'd be. do I need to...
to leave the door open. Thank you.